So today it's concentration time. I want to talk about the concentration phenomena, which we still need to close the gap in the proof from last time, but also to understand that actually the convergence in our random matrix context is usually very strong convergence. So it's not just on average, but it's more that typically our eigenvalue distributions converge. So this is chapter 6 on concentration phenomena. And this will then also correspond to stronger forms of convergence in the semicircle law. Stronger forms of convergence. For the semicircle law. Okay, so let me recall again what we essentially did or looked at last time, in particular what kind of convergence we had. Okay, so we have a random matrix ensemble, which is given by a probability measure on the space of our random matrices. Okay, so our random matrix ensemble is given by probability measures for each n. N is the size of the matrix, so our random matrix ensembles is or are given by probability measures, one for each n. Okay, so for n we have Pn, and this is a probability measure on the set omega n of the matrices which we consider. So typically those are symmetric or self-adjoint n by n matrices of n times n matrices. And then we take the eigenvalue distribution of our matrices, which we encode as a probability measure on R, and we want to see that this converges weakly to the semicircle. So, and we want to see that the eigenvalue distribution mu an converges in the canonical notion of convergence for probability measures, namely the weak convergence, so it converges weakly to the semicircle distribution. Good. And in our analytic approach, we see this, or we want to see this by looking on the Stieltjes transforms. Also, equivalently, that's what we really are checking, that for all set, let's say in the upper half plane, we have that the corresponding Stieltjes transforms of those eigenvalue distributions converges. So the S mu an of set converges to the Stieltjes transform of the semicircle. Good. Okay, now of course the question is, so we want that the Stieltjes transforms converge, but what kind of convergence should this be with respect to our probability measure? Of course, it doesn't mean that for all matrices it converges. It means, what we in principle would like to see is that it for more or less generic choices it converges, and what we have done up to now was it converges on average. Okay, so we should talk a little bit about this. So there are different levels of this convergence with respect to the PNs. So there are different levels of convergence, of this convergence with respect to the PNs. Okay, and what we considered up to now was the convergence in average. That's what we more or less proved last time. So we have the convergence in average, which means we are taking our eigenvalue distributions, but we're averaging over all the matrices which we have with respect to this probability measure Pn. So we take the expectation of the μ's, or in we take the average over the Stieltjes transforms of all of them. So the Stieltjes transform of An. So for each set we do this. So we average over all Stieltjes transforms for all our matrices, and we want to see that this converges to the Stieltjes transform of the semicircle. Good. Okay, but the idea is, of course, that we should have a better kind of convergence, namely that most of the matrices converge. And so maybe this is best captured by the notion of convergence in probability, which tells us that maybe for most of our matrices we have this convergence. Or this means that for fixed n, most of the Stieltjes transforms are close to the Stieltjes transform of the semicircle. So this means that the probability where we are not close is small, or goes to zero if n goes to infinity. So the probability of those matrices for which the Stieltjes transform of my matrix at a point z, so again we do this, we require this for any set, the difference from the Stieltjes transform of our matrix to the Stieltjes transform of the semicircle, where this is bigger than epsilon, well, let's say greater equal to epsilon, that this probability should go to zero if n goes to infinity. Now, of course, for finite n, we will be somehow away for some epsilon, but if n is getting bigger and bigger, I mean, then most of the matrices should not have a distance epsilon, and actually this probability should go to zero if n goes to infinity. And this should be true for any epsilon bigger than zero. So that's maybe fits best with this intuition that actually in most of the pictures we should see a histogram which is close to the histogram of the semicircle. And actually, I mean, there's even a stronger notion of convergence, namely almost sure convergence, which really tells us that generically, if we are choosing randomly any sequence of matrices, we should converge. So I'm writing this down, but I'm not going to talk more about this because I don't want to talk about the probability measure on the space of all sequences. Okay, but in principle, maybe that's the strongest form, that we have almost sure convergence. And this means that actually if you're looking on a probability of sequences, I mean, because what here we are looking on a fixed n, but the idea is we are taking a sequence of matrices n goes to infinity, and then it should converge. And the probability that it doesn't converge should be equal to zero. So the probability of sequences of matrices such that for our given set, the sequence of the corresponding Stieltjes transforms does not converge to the Stieltjes transform of the semicircle, this probability should be equal to zero. Okay, of course, for this I should tell you what is the probability measure on the space of sequences. But actually, I mean, the only thing which I want to see is that this here usually is shown, can be guaranteed, if you see that this convergence here is even stronger. Okay, so usually you use a Borel-Cantelli lemma to get this here if you have something stronger on this. So maybe let me write this down. So this almost sure convergence is guaranteed via the so-called Borel-Cantelli, by, I don't know, one of them, there are two, but the general one, where you don't need independence, by Borel-Cantelli lemma. If the convergence here is actually stronger. It's not just saying that this probability goes to zero, but actually it should go so fast to zero in n that it is summable. So this means essentially it should go like 1 over n squared, for example. 1 over n is not good enough. I mean, 1 over n would still mean it converges in probability, but might not guarantee that I have almost sure. Yeah? Yeah, yeah, I mean, this almost sure is stronger. But not the other way around. No, no, they are not equivalent. This is weaker. Convergence in probability is weaker than almost sure convergence. And I'm saying, I mean, here I'm, maybe let me write it down. So by the Borel-Cantel dilemma, if the convergence, so if the convergence in two, a convergence for in probability to zero is sufficiently fast. Two only requires that it goes to zero. It's sufficiently fast in n. Namely, so fast that if I'm summing over all those probabilities, so fixing epsilon and then summing over the probabilities in n, this should be summable. So that the sum over n of the pn of the ans, the distance between the Stieltjes transform of an and the Stieltjes transform of the semicircle is greater than epsilon, that this is less than infinity. Okay. So it could be that this probability in n behaves like 1 over n. Then I have convergence in probability, but 1 over n is not summable. I don't have almost sure convergence. So almost sure, it should be, usually you can show estimates that those probabilities behave like 1 over n squared. And then this here is summable, which means you also have almost sure convergence. Good, but anyhow, so in any case, I mean, what we really want to understand are probabilities like this. Yeah, good, and so what we have here, I mean, what you should notice, I mean, what we want is a convergence of a probabilistic quantity to a deterministic quantity. I mean, this here is the semicircle. That's the Stieltjes transform of the semicircle. That's a deterministic quantity. There's no randomness. But of course, here with the random matrices, we have a randomness here, and we want to have convergence of this probabilistic quantity to the deterministic. And in 2 and 3, essentially, one is saying somehow that one has a kind of concentration. So because this is saying that actually, I mean, this here in the limit will be the average from 1. So this here is telling us that essentially the Stieltjes transform for most of the random matrices is close to the average of them. And that's what we are meaning with concentration. So 2 and 3 are saying somehow that that for large n, the eigenvalues concentrate in the neighborhood of the semicircle. So 2 and 3 are saying that for large n, the eigenvalue distribution of my random matrix, of my matrix AN, concentrates in a small neighborhood of the semicircle. Okay, and this is a kind of, this is an instance of a general phenomena, which is this concentration of measure phenomena. Concentration of measure. Okay, and this concentration of measure phenomena is a quite big topic in mathematics. So in particular, I mean, yeah, in the last decades, there has been a lot about this. So it's concentration of measure in high-dimensional spaces. I mean, our matrices, of course, are living in high-dimensional spaces if we make n big. Because the entries, so we have of the order n squared entries of our matrix, so we are, our integrals are integrals over n squared dimensional spaces. So if n is large, those are really high dimensional spaces, and in those we have concentration of some quantities of interest. I mean, the quantity of interest is the Stieltjes transform, which is a function of those n squared variables. Okay, and maybe here's a slogan for this concentration of measure, what it is saying, so just in very general form. So this is according to Michel Talagrand, who has done a lot of important work in this direction. So maybe here's the slogan for concentration of measure. What does it mean? So it says a random variable that depends on on many independent variables, and of course it should depend somehow in a smooth way. Of course this has to be specified in concrete situations. So a random variable that depends in a smooth way on the influence of many independent variables. But of course in such a way that none of the variables really dominates. So it shouldn't depend too much on any of them. So of many independent variables, but not too much on any of them. Then actually this random variable is essentially constant. Okay, so this is according to Michel Talagrand. Good. Okay, so this means if I have a function of many variables, as for example our Stieltjes transform, the Stieltjes transform is a variable of the input of the entries of our matrix, and the entries of our matrix are independent, then essentially this guy does not really depend on the actual values. So this means if I have many independent variables, usually they are not working together to give an effect. Usually they are just canceling each other in some sense. Good. Okay, but of course we have to make this precise, and I want to talk a little bit about such things, but of course mostly streamlined to what we want in the context of our random matrix situation. But I mean, this is really a very general phenomena. And in particular, we are interested in kind of probabilistic phenomena. And essentially, one can see, one can look on many things which are done usually in probability theory as an instance of this for linear functions. Because if you're looking on the law of large numbers or the central limit theorem, you are looking on the sum of independent random variables. And the sum, of course, is a very special function. But the point here is, this is not only true for linear functions, but more or less for any smooth function. Because, I mean, the Stieltjes transform is, of course, not a linear function in the entries. It's a more complicated function. But that's for which we want to apply something like this. But many things in classical probability theory are in this can be seen in this way. The law of large numbers essentially tells you that if you are averaging your sum, then you are close to the expectation with very high probability. That's exactly what we have there. Okay, so let me maybe write this general statement also down, and then getting more concrete in this direction. So maybe, note that many classical results in probability theory and a prototypical example of this is the law of large numbers. Which says that the average, that you take the average over independent realizations of a given distribution converges to the expectation. This is exactly this. Okay, so this can be seen. As instances of this. But there, very often, or I mean, in those contexts, you are dealing with linear functions. Okay, and I mean, maybe more modern or, a lot of important progress is that actually this is also true for a big class of nonlinear functions. So, however, this principle also applies to nonlinear functions. And that's exactly what we have in our situation because our function is the trace of the Stieltjes transform. So like in our case, what we want is to take the trace, the trace of the resolvent, so an minus z to the minus 1. And this is the Stieltjes transform of the eigenvalue distribution of this guy. So this this is our function. And this, of course, is a function in the entries of the matrix, considered as a function the entries of an. And of course, in our random matrix ensembles, we are choosing the entries independent. So this is really a function of independent random variables. Good. Okay, and now the question, of course, is, this is a nice slogan, but of course we have to prove something like this, that this actually happens. And in this probabilistic context, usually a good control for such concentration is given by the variance of the involved variables. So we will first look on this and see how we can use this. So often control of the variance of the involved variables is a good way to control concentration or to get concentration estimates of the involved variables is a good way to get concentration estimates. Okay, and so maybe I start with maybe the two basic or the basic estimate for the variance, so with the Markov and the Chebyshev inequality. But maybe, so let me recall again maybe the abstract setting. So I mean, for those, we are just talking about, let's say, we have a random variable on a space omega, and on this we have a probability measure, so P is a probability measure on a set omega. And then we have a random variable. I mean, a random variable is just a measurable function from omega to the R. Usually our random variables are real valued, or then sometimes we also take tuples of random variables and then they are R to the n valued, the tuples. Okay, so a random variable x from omega to R is a measurable function. So in particular, this means we can integrate it with respect to P. And then, of course, the two yeah, The main notion is, of course, taking the integral, or the expectation. So the expectation of our random variable x, of course, is taking, integrating our function x with respect to the probability measure over the set omega. Okay, this is integration in the abstract space omega, but of course we can also replace this by integrating over R with respect to the distribution of our measure, the distribution of the variable, which is the push forward of the measure from here to here. So it's a probability measure on R. So of course, so this can also be written as an integral over R. Here I'm integrating over the variable x, but with respect to a probability measure, which is the distribution of my variable x. This is the probability measure. This is the push forward of this measure. Okay, I mean, that's usually how we are doing integrations if we want to calculate something explicitly. Okay, but for abstract theorems, it's nicer to work in this abstract space. Good, okay, so this here is the distribution of the random variable x. A probability measure So I mean, if I have my Gaussian random variables, then of course their distribution is e to the minus x squared divided by 2 as a density with respect to Lebesgue measure. Good. Okay. And so now there are very basic inequalities, which tells us that the expectation and later also the variance, they tell us something about deviations of the variables from their mean or whatever. And so maybe the basic one, which is the Markov inequality, just uses the expectation. I mean, this is just a starting point. We want to refine this to the Chebyshev one, which is the more interesting one, and using the variance, but we start with this one. Okay, so this is about a random variable, so x be a random variable. Which should be positive, or it should not take on negative values. So taking non-negative, so greater or equal to zero values. Good. Okay, and then if I know the expectation, this tells me something about probabilities for taking on high values. So I mean, if I know the expectation, then I know something about the random variable, then I mean, it cannot be too large. It cannot be too far away from the expectation. Of course, there can always be instances where I can have very large values, but they cannot occur so often. So the probability of them should be small. I can estimate it. Good. So the statement is, for any t bigger than zero, I have that the probability of those omegas for which x of omega is greater or equal to t, that this can be estimated by the expectation of x divided by t. Of course, this is only an interesting estimate if t is bigger than the expectation. Because otherwise, I mean, this here is bigger than 1 and probabilities are always less than 1. This doesn't tell me anything. But if I take t big or very big compared to the expectation, then this means I don't see too many values which are so big. Okay, so this gives me an estimate. I mean, this is a trivial estimate, but yeah, quite useful. I mean, it tells you there is some information in the expectation. Good, so let us prove this. So we are fixing a t. And then I'm just writing down the expectation as an integral and then just making an estimate by dividing the integration into two parts. Okay. So, I mean, Of course, we have to use somehow that our value is always positive. That's our assumption that I have a non-negative random variable. Good, but then the expectation of x, of course, by definition, is the integral over x omega dp omega. And now I'm splitting this integration into two parts, where I sum over the omegas for which x has a value greater than t and for which it has a value less than t. So I'm just decomposing omega into two sets. So the first set is the omegas for which x of omega is, let's say, less than t. And the second part is just a complement, namely where omega is greater or equal than t. X von omega dp omega. Good. Okay, now I want to estimate. So you see, I want bring this t on the other side, so I want to estimate in this direction. So I want to get this is greater or equal than something. And here, I know something about the x, so I can estimate it. And this term, okay, I cannot estimate this, but because I know that x is positive, this guy is always greater or equal to zero, so I just throw this term away. And if I throw it away, I will get a greater or equal than the other term. So that's the term where x of omega is greater or equal than t, x omega dp omega. But then over this domain, I can estimate this here by the constant function t. T is just a constant, t times identity. So I can estimate this. So this is greater than integrating over the same domain. And here, x of omega, I can estimate this by t. But then the t goes out, and I'm just integrating over, just integrating the constant function 1 over the set with this property. But this just gives me the probability of this set. So this here is just t times the probability of this set, and this set is exactly what I'm interested in. That's the omegas, where x of omega is greater or equal than t. And so you see I have exactly what I want, namely this probability here is less than, and here I have the t. Okay, so this t times this probability is less than the expectation, or if I bring the t on the other side, I get exactly this here. Good, okay, so that's the Markov inequality. But maybe more important is that one can refine this to Chebyshev inequality, which uses the information about the variance. So here, this is only for variables which have to be positive. And of course, I mean, in general, I want to consider general random variables. But this can be done with the Chebyshev inequality. So that's the real one. That's the one which involves the variance. And maybe let me just recall the notations also for the variance in this setting. Okay, so for a random variable, so a measurable function from omega to r, we have the expectation, which I already wrote down, but let me write it down again. So the expectation is just the integral over x of omega dp omega over omega. And then the variance is somehow, measures how far x is away from the expectation. So the variance of my variable x, this is, let's say, the expectation of x minus the expectation. Okay, so I take x, the difference to the expectation, and I take the square of this, so that every deviation counts, and then I average over this. Okay, and if you multiply this out, of course, this is also the same as the expectation of x squared minus the square of the expectation of x. Okay, and maybe let me also write this again in terms of the integral. So this here, this expectation here is the integral of my function x of omega, and I'm comparing this with the expectation. Expectation was of course this integral, but this is just a fixed number. I'm taking the square of this and average over this with respect to my measure. So I mean, this really shows you that the variance is really somehow the information how far my random variable is away from its average. So it's clear that the variance captures information about this, and in particular, the next Chebyshev inequality makes clear that this really gives you also probabilities for being away for some value. The Chebyshev inequality is just using the Markov inequality for some special choice of your variables. So the proof. So what is the statement? Now we consider a random variable without any assumption whether it's positive or negative. It can be just any values in R, and we need that the variance exists. Now of course here, of course in Markov inequality, I should assume that the expectation exists, because otherwise of course this doesn't say anything. Then of course for the Chebyshev, I will assume that the variance exists, otherwise it doesn't has a content. I mean, it's still true because everything is less than infinity, but it's not very useful. But we don't need higher moments. So the point here is, if you have a variable and it has an expectation and a variance, then you can make estimates even if higher moments don't exist. Of course, if you have higher moments, then they might contain more information. But this information is getting a bit more complicated, so usually the Chebyshev inequality is the main important one. So Chebyshev inequality. So what does this say? So we have a random variable. So let x be a random variable. Of course, again, a real valued. So let's say x from omega to r. And we assume it has a mean. Let me call this mu with mean. Okay, mu, of course, mu is not a good name because, anyhow. Yeah, let me call it mu. And variance, which we call sigma squared. Good, and then I can have, then I have an estimate of the probability that I have a deviation from the mean, and this probability I can now estimate in terms of the variance. So then, for any epsilon bigger than zero, we have that the probability for the situation where my variable x of omega has a distance to the mean, which is bigger than epsilon, this can be now estimated by sigma squared over epsilon squared. So it's very similar to the Markov, but now it's in terms of the variance, and it's also the deviation from the mean. And again, of course, I mean, epsilon is maybe also not a good name, I mean, because this only is a good estimate if epsilon is big, not small. Again, I mean, this side here, I only get something if this side here is less than one. Otherwise, it doesn't say any. So this tells me if epsilon squared is sigma squared, then I get here one. Up to this point, up to this epsilon, I don't get anything. But then if my epsilon is getting bigger than the variance, then I really get estimates. So this tells me if I'm much more away than the variance from my mean, then this happens not with small probability. Good, okay. And the proof of this is just to use Markov's inequality essentially for the square of this guy. So use Markov inequality for, okay, I mean, I should have a positive random variable, of course, but I'm taking the square of exactly what I'm interested, the difference to mu. So for a positive random variable, let me call it y, and this is just x minus mu squared. So this is a positive random variable, and so I can apply Markov inequality to it. And of course, what is the expectation? So in a Markov inequality, I need the expectation of y. So what is the expectation of y? This is of course the expectation of, yeah, what is this y? This is x minus mu. Mu is the expectation of x. I'm taking the square of this. But this is by definition just the variance of x. The variance of x, which I call here sigma squared. So you see the expectation of this y is nothing else than the variance of x. And then you see how I get the Chebyshev inequality from the Markov inequality. So namely, thus we have the probability of the omegas for which x of omega minus mu is greater than epsilon. That's what I want to know. And now, of course, I mean, I should go over to this guy here, to the square, because the expectation of this is the variance. But this I can do by just squaring this inequality. Asking that this is bigger than epsilon, of course, is the same as asking that the square of this is bigger than the square of epsilon. So this here is the same as the probability of the omegas for which x of omega minus mu squared is greater or equal than epsilon squared. So that's the same condition. And for this now, I can use Markov inequality. And this tells me that this here is less or equal. I mean, this here is y. This here was y. Then Markov inequality tells me that this is less or equal the expectation of y divided by what I have here. This is epsilon squared. And the expectation of y was exactly the variance of x divided by epsilon squared. Good. Okay, so this really shows us somehow that the variance is a good quantity for telling us something about concentration. Of course, if we can show that the variance is small. Of course, if I just have a random variable in R, I have a distribution which has some variance. And of course, I mean, there I don't have concentration. I mean, in general, I mean, if I have a distribution, of course, I mean, there are values which are away from the mean. Okay. But the point is, in high dimensions, the variance will get very small. I will get very peaked distributions. So the point will be for us to control or to see that the variances in the high dimensions for our situation, we can estimate them to be small. Yeah, so let me write this maybe as a remark. So what we are interested in so our goal will thus be to control the variance of the function in which we are interested. And the function in which we are interested is actually the resolvent. Okay, so we want to control the variance of, yeah, let's say x, which is a function of independent variables for x1 up to xn, independent random variables. And in our case, the xi's are the entries of our GOE matrix A, and the function which we consider is the trace of the resolvent. And f is the trace of the resolvent A minus z times 1 to the minus 1. So we have many functions, we have many independent variables, and then we take one function of them. And this guy has then, of course, the distribution is a distribution on R, but this guy should have the variance of this distribution should be small. And of course, I mean, the point is, how can one prove such things? And I mean, this is not trivial in a sense. I mean, one needs some tool or maybe general machinery for proving such things. And one of the main ideas in this context is that, I mean, the general idea is I have a function of many variables. And I mean, each variable has only a small influence. So this tells me that actually, I have control on each of the variables, but I want to go over to control of all the variables together. And this means I should have estimates or whatever, which somehow are stable and are going from estimates from the from each of the variables to estimates in joint of the variables. And this is somehow an instance of what is called tensorization, because I have inequalities which are true on some space or on some spaces, and then I take the tensor product of the spaces, and the tensor product corresponds to taking independent copies of the variables, and then I should still have a control in the same way. And the control should not depend on n. So I mean, you would expect I can control each variable, let's say it has an influence 1, and then if I have n variables, you would a priori think, I mean, I have an influence which is of the order n. But the point is, you would like to have a machinery which tells you if you have an influence of order 1 for each of the variables, also independent copies of n of the variables together also has only influence 1. So you should be able to tensorize your control without getting worse constants. So the main idea in this context is to have estimates, for example, for the variances, which go over from separate control of each variable. So this tells me that each variable has only a small influence on the function, but I want to go over from separate control to control of all variables together, to control of all variables together. And this means I want somehow estimates which are stable under taking tensor products. Tensorization. So it has they which are stable under tensorization. So in our context, this means I'm taking independent copies of all my variables. And I want to control what happens then. And yeah, there are, so one needs somehow, I cannot just control the variance directly in this way, but I need some properties which have this behavior. And there are two types of estimates in this context which have this stability, and one is the Poincaré inequality, and the other is the logarithmic Sobolev inequality. Okay, so and I will mainly talk about the Poincaré inequality in the following, but I just want to point out that there are two prominent types of estimates which give a very effective machinery. So prominent types of such estimates, namely the first one are so-called Poincaré inequalities, and I will mainly talk about this. And there is something else which might even give stronger results, namely LSI, which means logarithmic Sobolev inequalities. So maybe later I will also say a little bit on this. Okay, but so I want to be more rigorous on the Poincaré inequalities, maybe because that's easier and more straightforward. And yeah, so maybe let me say right away what is a Poincaré inequality. And then we try to understand this a little bit and see also how it can be used. So a Poincaré inequality is a property of my measure. I'm looking on a measure, let's say in R to the n, which means I'm looking on n variables, and this measure should have a property which allows me to control functions of the variables. And in particular, it allows me to compare various integrals. So 6.6. So we say that a random variable x, and this x is now a tuple of, let's say, random variables. I mean, they don't have a priori; they don't have to be independent. I mean, for this definition, they can be general. But if one wants to prove such things by reducing it to the variables themselves, then very often independence is crucial. Good, but so a random variable, we say it satisfies. So satisfies Poincaré inequality. And we have an inequality where we have somehow a constant there, c, and so maybe we say it satisfies a Poincaré inequality with constant c. C is bigger than zero. If for any nice function, so if, let's say, for any differentiable, for any differentiable function, maybe with the expectation, so L2 integrable function, we have, the conditions are essentially so that the inequality which I'm writing down makes sense. Both sides make sense. So that I can estimate the variance of this function, and of course, that's things I'm interested in, but I can estimate this against the expectation of the derivative of the function. So I can compare the function with its derivative. So this is less or equal. Here I have a c, and here I have the expectation of, I take here the derivative, the gradient of f of x, and I take here the two norms squared. So this is just the sum over the square of all derivatives. So maybe I just write it here. So this is just a short form. It's a norm, L2 norm of the gradient. So the gradient of this function, the square of the L2 norm, is nothing else than the sum of the squares of all the partial derivatives. So this is the sum of the partial derivatives of my function f. F is a function of n variables. Maybe I haven't said it any different. I mean, f is a function from r to the n to r, so that I can plug in my variables in this function. So x is a tuple. Okay, and here I have the partial derivatives of f, and I take the square of this. Yeah, good. Okay, and I mean, this is a statement which is not so clear. And of course, the point is that this should be true for more or less all f. It's not just that you require for one f something, but you want this for all f's, with the same constant c here. So this means you can control the variance of more or less any function, nice functions, in your tuple of operators by taking derivatives of the function in your variables. And this is a quite useful thing. And I mean, this is a quite non-trivial property. This is nothing which you have for free. So the point is really for which random variables, or for which distributions of my random variables do we have properties like this? Okay, if you have something like this, then we can control the variance, and we can also control then concentration. And maybe let me write this again down in the in R to the n as an integral in R to the n, just to maybe to get maybe a better feeling that this is really a not non-trivial statement, which really is a condition on my probability on the distribution of my random variables. And a priori, it's not clear that I have any variables which satisfy something like this. Of course, I mean, if I'm making this definition, it should be clear that there will be interesting situations for which this is true and where we can use this. Yeah, so maybe let me write this explicitly. Just to explicitly in terms of the distribution which I call mu x of the tuple x. I mean, x is this function from omega to r to the n. So x is the tuple of my random variables. So this tuple is a function from omega to r to the n, and the distribution is the push forward of my probability measure p to r to the n. So this is a measure on r to the n. And of course, I can write those guys here in terms of this. So of course, the expectation of f of x is of course nothing else than integrating over r to the n, just the function f in the variables x1 up to xn with respect to the measure mu on r to the n. So mu, I mean, here in this language, mu is just a measure on r to the n, and the expectation is just integrating the function with this. And then, what does this Poincaré inequality mean? Then I have to take the variance of my function, and this is again, this is an integral over r to the n of my function f x1 up to xn, taking the difference to the expectation, which is just a fixed value. This is this fixed value here. So I'm taking for each x1 up to xn, I'm taking this difference, squaring this, and integrate this with respect to my measure mu. That's this side, and now the Poincaré inequality asks that this can be estimated by this. So this should be less or equal, but that's of course the requirement of the Poincaré inequality, c times the sum over the square of the derivatives. So again, here an integral in r to the n, d f, the partial derivative of my function, and I take this at the variables x1 up to xn. I take the square of this and integrate with respect to my measure mu. And I mean, this is, so I mean, I'm controlling essentially the integral over the square of the function by the integral over the square of the derivatives. Well, and that this is possible is not clear. This is a condition on a measure mu, because I'm requiring this for all nice functions f. Okay, so this is a condition. On mu. Good, and of course, I mean, our main interest, of course, what are our random variables? They are the entries of our matrix, so they are independent Gaussian ones. So of course, I mean, if this is of any use for us, it should be true that independent Gaussian random variables satisfy this. And that's one of the main statements which we are going to prove, that actually we have, if I have independent standard Gaussian variables, then I have this inequality and the constant is just one. And the point here is, of course, this constant does not depend on the dimension. It's a dimension-free inequality. Usually with many inequalities, depending on the dimension over which you integrate, you have constants which are getting worse and worse if you are increasing the dimension. And the usefulness of inequalities like this is that typically they are true for all dimensions. You don't have constants depending on the dimension. And the idea is that you have this tensorization. If you know it for small spaces, you can put them together tensoring and the constants are not getting worse. You're keeping your constants. Good. Okay, and for proving such things or controlling this, or I mean proving Poincaré inequalities for something, we should essentially see that it has this tensorization property. That's the crucial point for many things which you want to do. And the crucial ingredient for this is another inequality, which is called Efron-Stein inequality, which essentially tells us what happens if we want to get the variance of a function of many variables, how we can relate this to the variance of the function in each of the variables separately. This is again this tensorization idea. This general idea that we try to understand the variance of the function jointly, the variance jointly in all variables, by understanding what happens if I'm just changing one of the variables. Okay, and this is can be very precisely controlled by what is called Efron-Stein inequality, and that's the next thing which I want to do. And of course, somehow, the problem with this tensorization stuff is that actually, I mean, expectations, of course, are linear. Okay, so that's not a problem. But the variance is a quadratic object, and you don't really know if you want to go over to bigger spaces. So the point is to control this also in a kind of linear way in terms of each of the variables. Yeah, and this can be done. So this is again a very nice, important general statement, which, I mean, appears in different contexts. But maybe this general version here usually goes under the name of Efron and Stein. Efron, Stein. Inequality. Okay, and of course, I mean, this is now the context where I'm taking independent variables. So this tensorization idea, of course, only applies directly if I have independent variables. So if I have a function on n variables, and on each of the variables, it only depends in a small way. The effect of each variable has only a small influence, and then if I want to expect that also all variables together have only a small influence, I need independent variables. Otherwise, it's okay, I need some very special situations. Of course, if all variables are the same, then of course they will have a much bigger influence. If all the variables are working together, then even if each has a small influence together, they have a big one. If the variables are independent, if each of them has only a small influence, they cannot work together because they are independent, and then all together they also have a small influence. Oh, that's the idea here. So this here is the setting where I have independent random variables x1 up to xn. Be independent. Random variables, and I consider now a function in them. So let f of x1 up to xn be say a square integrable function. Well, maybe as we have there, integrable function of the tuple of all of x1 up to xn, or I could say it's a function of this tuple. Good, and then my claim is then we have that actually I can estimate the variance of this function f of x by the sum over each of the variables, essentially, and I'm taking the variance of the function, but only the variance with respect to the variable xi. And then I'm averaging over all of this. So I take here the expectation of the variance, but the variance with respect to the variable xi of my function f of x. So what does this mean? This means I'm taking the variance of this function only in the ith variable. So this is a function of n variables, but I'm fixing all but the ith variable, and then I'm just taking the variance in this variable. And so this guy is still a function of all the other variables. And the expectation which I have here is over all the other variables. So this here means taking the variance only in the ith variable and keeping all the other variables fixed. So this here just involves integration over the ith variable. And then here I'm integrating over all the other ones. So this here is integrating over all other variables. Good. And the proof of this. And the proof of this essentially is, for the variance, we have to do integration over all variables. And the proof, the idea will be that we do this integration one after the other, and we try to control what happens if we between each of these steps. Good, so I think I can erase this for now. We'll come back to this later. But this Efron-Stein inequality is somehow the basic baby version on which many things rest, and which already contains the main idea that having control for each of the variables gives you control over all the variables together. For independent random variables. Good, so maybe, let me just recall again what the quantities we have here and also introduce some notations. So I have this function of my variables which I want to consider, and let me call this set. So set is this function of f1 up to xn. That's the variable for which I want to estimate the variance. And then we have, and maybe let me write down again what I have here, the expectation of z. And I write this again as an integration over R to the N. Also this is the integration over R to the N of my function f x1 up to xn. And now I integrate with respect to the distribution of this tuple x1 up to xn, but because they are independent, this is just a product measure. So I mean I have a distribution for each of them, and I'm just integrating with respect to each of them. So I have here d mu1 of x1 up to d mu n of xn. That's the assumption that I have here independent random variables, which tells me that I have here a product measure, which essentially tells me that I can do iterated integration. For each of the variables, I integrate with respect to one measure. Good, okay, and so mu I here is the distribution of xi. This is a probability measure on R. So each of the variables, each of the xi's is real valued. And because the x1 up to xn are independent, the distribution of this tuple, of this variable x, which is r to the n valued, this is just this vector x1 up to xn. So this is given by the product measure, as I have written it there. By the product measure, mu1 times up to mu n on r to the n. So this just means the integration with respect to this product measure is just given by this. Good, and so what I really want to estimate is the variance of set. So maybe let me also write down the variance of set explicitly. So this is again the integral over r to the n. Then I take, so set is this function, so I take this function x1 up to xn, take the difference to the expectation, which is this number, which I have there, take the square of this and integrate this with respect to my product measure. D mu 1 of x1 up to d mu n of xn. So this is just an n-fold integral. And now, in order to control this somehow in the single variables, I'm now doing this integral here, one after the other. And then I want to see how I get from set to the whole integral. So, I mean, the idea is integrating one variable at a time and controlling somehow each of the steps. Or more formally, so what I need, I mean, for my variance, I have to integrate set minus the expectation of set squared. So I mean, this variance is set minus the expectation of set. So the square of this. That's what I'm integrating here. But now I write this in terms of doing one integration at a time. So I mean, this expectation here is integrating over all variables. But I write this as, okay, integrating only over the first variable. Okay. Then, making the step from integrating over the first variable to integrating over the first and the second variable. Then, integrate the difference between integration over the first and the second and integration over the first three variables, and so on, up to the point where I have here integrated over all but the last variables. And then here I'm integrating over all of them, which is just the expectation. So you see I'm writing set minus its expectation. So I have it here, set minus the expectation. And the other terms are just all going away. They are all appearing twice. They are going away, but I make this transition from here to here in steps where I'm integrating one variable after the other. So here the notation is, I mean, where if I'm writing E1 up to K, so this should denote integration over the first K variables. And this, of course, leaves me a function which depends on the remaining variables. So this denotes integration over the variables x1 up to xk, and this leaves the function. So after this integration, I'm left with something which still depends on the other variables. So leaving a function of the variables xk plus 1 up to xn. Good. Okay, so now I denote these differences here by delta. Huh? So this here I'm going to call, this here I'm calling delta 1, this here I'm calling delta 2, delta 3, up to delta n, and then I have written this guy here as the sum of those deltas. And then I'm trying to estimate the expectation of this guy squared in terms of the deltas, and hopefully the deltas have enough structure that I really can use them to get something like this. Yeah, so I'm writing now these deltas, so maybe let me define them. So das with, so the delta I, this is, I'm taking the integration over the first I minus 1 variables, and I'm subtracting where I integrate one variable more. So namely I'm integrating from 1 up to I minus 1 and I. So you see, I mean, I'm subtracting always something where I integrate one variable more than before. So I'm calling those guys delta I, and they are functions of which variables? Of the variables. So this is a function of the variables xi up to xn. I have integrated out the variables. Here I have integrated out the first I minus 1 variables. Here I have integrated one more, but at least here I have still the variables xi up to xn. Good, and so with this we have that set minus the expectation of set, which is what I need to use in my variance, that I can write this now as a sum of those delta. So delta I from 1 up to n. I have written it in terms of steps where I just do one integration. And then, of course, the variance of set can now be written in terms of the deltas. And thus, the variance of set is of course the expectation of set minus the expectation of set squared, but set minus expectation of set I have written as the sum over the delta i's. So what I have here is really the expectation of the sum of the delta I squared. The sum is running over I from 1 up to n, and I'm having the sum of those guys squares, and if I multiply this out, of course I get quadratic terms in the deltas, and in principle I get diagonal terms. So I get the sum where the I is equal. So I get this twice. So I get the delta I squared from I equal 1 to n, the expectation of this. But of course, I get also the off-diagonal terms where I have here delta I and delta j. So plus the sum where I is different from j, the expectation delta I times delta j. And of course, a priori, the problem is the variance is it's quadratic. And you see here, if I do this decomposition, I get quadratic things. Those are nice things, and those things, the point is that I can control this. Actually, they are zero, they disappear. That's the main point here, which makes the variance linear somehow. From classically, the variance of the sum of independent variables is the sum of the variances. And here we are doing a more elaborate version of this. But that's the main point, that we can linearize somehow the variance because of the independence. So that's the crucial observation now, that those guys actually are zero. And maybe I just do it concretely for a special case, but it's also the same in general. So the general observation is that the off-diagonal terms there, which means I different from j, they are zero. So the expectation of delta I times the expectation of delta j is equal to zero. So in more fancy terms, what we are doing here is a kind of martingale writing of those things. But I mean, I'm just doing it explicitly. And I mean, just one should, to see this, let me, for example, take a delta 1 times delta 2, just to see it concretely. But in general, it works the same. So for example, so let me consider I is equal to 1. J is equal to 2, and let's also say n is equal to 2 because the other variables don't play a role for this. And then just write it down explicitly, also to make sure that we understand what we are really doing here. So what is the expectation of delta 1 times delta 2? So this is the expectation of, so delta 1 is set minus the expectation with respect to the first variable of set, and we are multiplying this with delta 2, which is the integral with respect to the first variable, and I'm subtract there where I also integrate the second variable. So that's just putting in again a definition of delta 1 and delta 2. And now maybe let me write down this more explicitly as integrals, what it really means. So I mean, this is a function of x1 and x2. So this integral here is still an integral over x1 and x2. I mean, those guys here are also integrals which I already have done before. So let me write it. Okay, so this here is an integral, over what? So what is here? Set is just f of x1, x2. X1 and x2 are the variables with respect to which I integrate at the end. Then I'm subtracting from this the function where I already have done the integration with respect to the first variable. So this is now f of x1, x2, but I have done the integration with respect to this variable. So let me denote it with x1 twiddle. So this guy is now just a function of x2. And I'm taking this difference. So this is this first guy here. And the second guy, I mean, here, this is the same as this. So this is where I have already integrated out the first variable. So this is f of x1 twiddle, x2, with respect to d mu 1 x1 twiddle. So this is still a function of x2. And from this, I'm subtracting this, where I have integrated out everything, which is just the expectation. So this is just a number, depending on nothing anymore. So I have here x1 twiddle, x2 twiddle, integrated with respect to d mu 1 x1 twiddle, d mu 2 x2 twiddle. And now, of course, I still have to integrate the whole thing. Okay, so this here. So I have this times this. And this is still a function here in x2, here in x2, and here in x1 and x2. And I'm integrating now with respect to d mu x1, d mu x2. But the point now is, of course, that the integration with respect to x2 doesn't affect this, because this guy here is not a function. It's a function of x2, but not a function of x1. So the x1 only appears here. So this means the integral over x1 only affects this. So I can take this out of the integration. And then I'm just integrating this over x1. But you see, if I'm integrating this over x1, I get exactly this term. So this difference will be zero. Yeah, essentially it means that this guy here is kind of orthogonal to this guy, and then I just take the expectation of this guy, but the expectation of the delta i's is trivially zero. Because the expectation just does the integration here, which I already have done here. Yeah, so. Good, still the theorem. Okay, so I think we can take this here away. And keep our conclusion that we have now essentially linearized the variance as a sum over corresponding contributions coming from I. Okay, but those I's are not yet where we want to go, because you see for the delta I's we are still integrating over a couple of variables. Here I only want to integrate over one of the variables in each step. But this connection can also be done. Good. Okay, so you see that this here is equal to zero. Yeah, so what we get, thus we get the variance of Z is now actually only the sum of the square terms. So it's just the sum I from 1 to n of the expectation of the delta I squares. Good, okay. And yeah, the delta i's, I mean delta I means I'm integrating the variables x1 up to xi. But what I really want is just to do the integration with respect to the variable xi. So maybe I should also have a symbol for this. So let me denote this by e subscript I. So this should be now the integration with respect to only the variable xi. And then, I mean, it still leaves me a function of all the other variables. Leaving a function of all the variables, I mean x1 up to xi minus 1, then xi is missing because I integrated over this, and then I still have xi plus 1 up to xn. Yeah, good. And of course, this variance here, this is the variance with respect to this ei. So, I mean, in terms of this, the variance I, which shows up in my theorem, this is really taking the variance with respect to looking on what happens with the ith variable, and all the other variables are kept constant. So this is integration, this is this ei of z minus ei of z squared and this. Good, yeah, but then we have, so now, I want now to relate, of course, what I have with this ei, because somehow I have to get from the expectation of the delta I squares, I have to get somehow to this guy here. So what we have is delta I, this is by definition integrating with respect to the first I minus one variables and subtracting where I integrate one variable more. Good, and this of course can now be written that I mean what I do in both expectations is integrating the first I minus one variables. Here I'm applying this to Z, and then here I should integrate one variable more, which I can also just do here. So I integrate here only the ith variable, and then doing the other ones here. I mean, expectations are linear. So this is the expectation of this guy, and the expectation of this guy is the same as this. Because I mean, doing the integration of the variables x1 up to xi means I'm just doing first integrations of the variables x1 up to xi minus 1 and then doing the integration with respect to xi. Yeah, good. So you see the delta I is the integral of something. And what we want is really the square of this guy. And what we have there is the square of this guy, or the expectation of this. Yeah. But now, actually, we can compare the square of this with the square of this, because there is a famous inequality for doing integration, which is Jensen's inequality, which tells you something for convex functions, but in particular, it tells you that the integral, that the integral of the square is bigger than the square of the integrals. Good, okay, so let me just finish this. So, so we have this, and from this we get by this Jensen's inequality, and thus, by Jensen's inequality, which is a general statement about how you compare the integral over function with the function of the integral for convex functions. And there you have this inequality. And so in our case, this tells me that if I take the square of my function, this is less than the integral e1 up to I minus 1 of z minus ei of set squared. Yeah, so you see, I mean, delta I is this integral. So delta I is a function of the variables xi up to xn, but those we are keeping fixed, and for each fixed choice, this here is just the integral over the other variables of this. Okay, so this is the integral of this, and then Jensen's inequality tells me that the square of this is less or equal than the integral over the square of the function. This is just Jensen's inequality for the square, and I'm doing it pointwise. So I mean, on both sides, I have things which are functions of the variables xi up to xn plus 1, and this is a pointwise thing. So I have this, and then I can take, of course, the variance. Because now you see, if I take now the expectation of this guy, then I will, of course, get it less than the expectation of this guy here. So thus, the variance of z, which, as we calculated, is the sum from 1 to n over the expectation of the delta I squared. Yeah, but this is now less or equal by this, what we just saw before. Less than equal than the expectation of, so the delta I squared is less than the the expectation of this guy is less than the expectation of this, but I mean the expectation is absorbed. This expectation is absorbed by the general expectation over everything. So I have here the expectation, and here I have z minus EI of z squared. Okay, and this here is just the variance with respect to the variable I. And that's what I wanted to show. So we have essentially two steps. We have seen that the variance is linearized by the sum over the expectation of the delta I squares, and the delta I squared I can I can write as estimate by Jensen's inequality with respect to this. Yeah, good. Okay, and so this proves this Efron-Stein inequality, and this gives a precise formulation of this idea that if I have a function of independent random variables and I can control the dependence of the function in each of the variables separately, then I can control also the function in all the variables together. And the control is not really getting much worse. So the influence. And in particular, next time, this will then give directly the fact that the Poincaré inequalities have this tensor property. Which means if I have variables for which I have a Poincaré inequality in each of the variables, I get directly a Poincaré inequality for all variables together, if they are independent. Good. Okay, but next time I will do this more precisely, so that's okay for today.